Good evening, everybody. I'm so excited to welcome you. My name is Ellie Confer. I'm the executive director of Hadar. This is the first in our four-part series about faith and doubt. And I'm very excited to welcome our speakers tonight, Rabbi Shaihel from Hadar, and Professor Michael Ruse, who's an expert in tonight's topic, which is about God, faith, and evolutionary biology. I want to make a couple of thank yous, and I'm going to hand over the mic before we turn it over to our panelists. The first thank you is to the Samuel Bronfman Foundation, who are represented here tonight by Connor Rauscher and R.A. Tuckman. We thought of this idea, it seems like many, many moons ago, and now it's come to fruition, and their support and encouragement has been instrumental in making this come together, and Shai is going to say something about the book, and as is Daniel. And the other thing I want to point out is that on your chairs, you will find a note card and a golf pencil. And the point of that is that when you feel moved to ask a question, instead of the traditional Jewish idea of shouting it out, you are going to write it down on the file card. We will collect them at various intervals. And if you win the lottery, it will be asked. But not every question will be asked, but only the ones that will make us look good. So the idea is that we all get to express our opinions, but we don't necessarily all have to listen to each other. And finally, I'm going to...
He's in rare form here.
It's my pleasure to welcome Daniel Septimus, who is the executive director of Safaria, to say a few words welcoming this evening and our guests.
So I'm here primarily as a friend and student of Edgar Bronfman, who we remember through his book, the last book that just came out, Why Be Jewish. And I was asked just to say a few words about Edgar and why a night like this would be meaningful to him. I first met Edgar when I became the editor of a website that he had founded called My Jewish Learning. Sorry. There we go. I met Edgar when I became editor of a website called My Jewish Learning that Edgar had founded, and I was invited to the office to meet with him. And what was so interesting and remarkable then and still today was that I wasn't invited to go over any plans that we had for the site or talk about metrics or his expectations, given that he had put several million dollars into this project. I was invited to teach some Torah. And I came, and it turned out it wasn't just to him, it was just full, a room full of people from the foundations and other people in the Jewish community. And it turned out this was something that Edgar did every week. Edgar would gather a group of people with a different teacher to sit and learn Torah. And so it's kind of amazing, actually, that with all of the possible associations you can have about Edgar Bronfman, the one that I always have is one of being Kovei Itim. Right, when I was setting aside time for learning Torah. He understood also that we only learn things when we have different people around us. And so it was really important to him that there be lots of different people. Strong opinions were often there, but having different opinions was absolutely essential. When Edgar passed away, a few of us went to do to be showman for his body, and I remember going with my Tehillim, and I see Yehuda Kurtzer, who was there before me, and we're both sort of like, this is kind of, how would Edgar feel about us sitting here with our like Tehillim, is this, I don't know how he would, what he would make of all this, but I sit down, I start Tehillim, and right away. And I think Edgar wouldn't have been surprised. I come to something remarkably meaningful and relevant, and that's in the first chapter of Tehillim. We have Kihesh Shatul Al Palgei Mayim, and he shall be like a tree planted by streams of water that brings forth its fruit in its season, and whose leaf does not wither, and in whatsoever he does, he shall prosper. Edgar was known to his grandchildren as Tree. The logo of his foundation was a tree, and I think he would have really appreciated also the interpretation of this pasuk in the Gemara in Avodah Zarah. With this, I'm going to leave it to these folks. Kol halome Torah mirav echad ino roes siman bracha le'olam. Right, why does it say a tree replanted and not a tree planted? Because if you only learn from one teacher, right, that's not really learning Torah. And I think that was one reason Edgar really appreciated this place, not just because it was a place that encouraged dialogue and conversation, but also because in the leadership, there's also this projection of it's absolutely important that there be multiple teachers of Torah. And it's one reason I'm so happy to be here tonight. I don't get to come here so much. I live all the way down south in Brooklyn. But I'm happy to be here.
The
Thank
deep
you
south.
For me and enjoy the
Thank
evening.
You. Thank you. Thank you, Daniel. And I'll just reiterate our thanks to the Samuel Bronfman Foundation and say that I hope this series is a fitting tribute to Edgar's memory. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Shai Held, co-founder and dean of Hadar. And I am extremely honored to welcome Professor Michael Ruse here this evening. Michael Ruse is a renowned philosopher and historian of science and one of the world's leading experts on the worldview and the writings of Charles Darwin. Professor Ruse has spent many decades, I would say, at the forefront of the dialogue between science and religion, and has written multiple books about the ways that evolutionary biology and theology have interacted, could interact, might yet interact. Michael Ruse is an atheist, but also a fierce critic of the new atheists, especially Richard Dawkins. And as we'll talk about later, the feelings are mutual. We'll talk about that. Since 2000, Professor Ruse has been, I'm going to pronounce her name wrong, the Lucille Werkmeister, or Werkmeister probably, professor of philosophy at Florida State University, and a really amazing, engaging writer, and it's really a great privilege for me to welcome you tonight, Michael. Michael and I are going to talk for a little while, then we'll kind of work through some of the questions that presumably will get passed forward, then he and I will talk some more, and then I hope, there'll be some time for further conversations. Further questions from the crowd. So just as a way of beginning, in your most recent book called, one of your most recent books, Michael writes books faster than I can read them, but in your most recent book, Atheism, What Everyone Needs to Know, you write, and I want to quote for a minute, "I still don't believe in most religious claims, so I suppose in this sense I am an atheist. Whether there is something more, I simply don't know. And in a way, I am glad that I don't know. I am nevertheless intensely religious, in the sense that these questions about God and the ultimate meaning of life are very important to me." And I will say, by the way, it struck me as I was reading the book how fitting it was to read a sentence like that in the context of a series in memory of Edgar Bronfman, who I think would have written that sentence himself. Every time I ever met Edgar, he told me within 3 minutes, "I don't believe in God," and then wanted to talk about it for the next 2 hours. But just to help us get to know you a little bit as a way of opening the conversation, Michael, I want to ask you if you could say a few words about just why these questions matter to you so much.
Well, first of all, is this on? Yes. Well, first of all, let me thank you very much for inviting me. I should say, I said I didn't want an honorarium, but if I could have an extra night and if the hotel could be close to the Metropolitan Opera, I'd be happy. So I should say last night I went to no less than 5 hours of William Tell by Rossini, the most atypical Rossini opera I've ever seen in my life. I swear to God it could have been written by Wagner and not just the length. Anyhow, so I'm all set. You told me we must, the building gets closed at midnight, so we must finish by 2:45. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
Which is just as well, because I'm a philosopher, and I probably won't get to the main verb until about 10:30. I was, obviously, I wasn't born on this side of the Atlantic. I can usually say, although I'm not sure I can say it to this audience, that I've lived in North America longer than you have. But I was born in England. Yeah, right. You're not that old, friend. You're not that old. But I was born in England in 1940 and grew up in England. And then emigrated to Canada in 1962. So I'd heard of the Bronfmans, but more in the alcoholic sense than otherwise. And I worked in Canada until 2000, and I still would be there. I love Canada. I mean, it's cold, but it's a wonderful country. They had, in those days, compulsory retirement at 65, and speaking as a high-status dominant male, it meant that I had a second wife and a large, small family, all of whom would have been teenagers when I retired, and that was an awful thought. So when I was offered a job in Florida, we took it, and I'm still there. And I love my job. That's mainly why I'm teaching. I mean, partly because my wife couldn't stand to have me around the house all day, and also I've got a son who's a philosopher, so a constant drain on the family finances. So I grew up as a Quaker. My father was a conscientious objector during the Second World War. He'd gone to Spain to fight in the Spanish Civil War, but he was very left-wing, and like a lot of people, when the Stalin-Hitler Pact was signed, he said, "I'm not fighting in the boss's war," and he didn't. I think he looked back in later life and said that probably wasn't the right decision. But anyhow, he worked on the land and came in contact with the Quakers, and after the war, he and my mother joined the Religious Society of Friends, and that was the religion I grew up in until I was about 20, when I didn't have a St. Paul on the way to Damascus experience in converse, as it were, and suddenly one day say, "Oh my goodness, God doesn't exist." It just sort of kind of like stamp collecting and fondness for baked beans. It was one of those things that kind of faded when I got to about the age of 20. But, you know, growing up as a Quaker, it was a very interesting, a very important experience, because Quakers don't have meeting houses, Quakers don't have priests, Quakers don't have a creed, Quakers don't have ceremony or any of these sorts of things. Nevertheless, and particularly in those days, I think less so today, but certainly in those days they were very firmly Christological. There was never any question that Jesus was the Son of God. And we junior young friends, as we were known in those days, were very much encouraged to be part of the community and to talk about these things and go along on Sundays and with sandwiches and spend 2 or 3 hours talking about these issues. For instance, what about being a pacifist? It wasn't easy to make a case for pacifism in the years after the Second World War, which had, particularly for the Brits, been a very good war, it was very difficult. And so we were told, well, don't take our word for it. Look at the Bible, talk about it, are there arguments? And so I grew up with these sorts of things as something which was intensely personal to me and intensely important. And the funny thing is, losing my faith was really almost unimportant in the sense that, like Edgar Bronfman, I went on being totally fascinated by these issues. And when I started teaching, one of the things I used to teach was philosophy of religion. And I've done that one way or another for the last 50 years. So this has always been very much part of my life. One final thing, and then you can ask another question. Well, actually, I've got about 4 final things.
You're ready for the rabbinate.
Yeah. One... One final thing is that I really thought when I was 20 or 21 that if when I get to 70, I'm going to be signing on again. You know, it would be a bad career mistake to get up there and face St. Peter. And he says, "Ah, yes, Michael Ruse, you don't believe, do you?" "Down there, mate, quickly." You know, by then I'd better say, "Oh, yes, I do believe in you, God, and I'm very sorry I didn't all those years." And I really thought that at the age of 70 or so, that my religious faith, not my interest in religion, that was always there, my religious faith would start to build again. And the funny thing is, and I'm 76 now, I find that it hasn't. I'm still very religious. I'm still, yeah, of course I'm in, I mean, professionally I'm interested in does God exist and those sorts of things. Of course I am. But I find that, in a way, God's existence and the prospect of eternity is not that important. much more important for me is from my part of the Bible, and as I was saying at supper, I'm a very conservative Protestant non-believer. From my part of the Bible, there's when Jesus talks about the use of your talents, and that has always been something tremendously important to me. I've been so privileged. I've grown up being given a good education, I've had good health, I've had several wonderful wives, all of those things. Well, two anyhow. But I've had all of these things, and so I felt very strongly the need to give back and to shape my life in that sort of way. And that, to me, is Bernard Williams, an English philosopher, wrote a book, an article called The Tedium of Immortality, and I feel a little bit that way. Much more important to me is that 76 years old, I'm being invited to come and talk to folks like you, and you know, folks who are sufficiently interested to turn out and want to listen and talk about these things. And you know, folks, I've taught for 52 years, all I hope is to do another 52 years, and I will die satisfied.
Great. Wow. So I want to start by getting the question of what's called the new atheism out of the way. Richard Dawkins has labeled you, now that you know about Professor Ruse, you can go back and read The God Delusion and see who the least popular person in that book is in many ways. Richard Dawkins has labeled you, with every ounce of derision he can muster, an accommodationist. He asserts that in making space for religion, you are selling out. And in one of his more unhinged moments, he refers to you as Neville Chamberlain. yet you wear the title of accommodationist in your writing with great pride. And you write about the new atheists, let me give a little quote here, that they are hectoring and arrogant. They are unfair to and belittling of others. And then one of my favorite sentences ever, they are ignorant of anything outside their disciplines to an extent remarkable even among modern academics. but I want to ask you on a deeper level, can you talk a little bit about the nature of your disagreement with Dawkins and Hitchens and the like? But on matters of style, sure, but also on matters of substance. And maybe also share a brief thought about where you think they're saying things that matter to you.
Well, obviously, the success of Dawkins and the others does show that at some level they were filling a gap. They were speaking to a need. And at that sort of level, I'm certainly not going to knock it. I mean, I'd much rather they were, you know, thinking about these sorts of things and arguing about these sorts of things than, you know, some of the banal things that people do talk about. So at one level, I won't say a sneaking sympathy, certainly envy. I mean, my God, three million books, I wouldn't mind that myself. But of course, they say that that's what motivates me. It's not really. So clearly they're speaking at some level to people out there. And obviously, and there's no question that Dawkins, particularly, and also Christopher Hitchens, have an ability with words and these things to catch the imagination that, you know, frankly, academics like me don't, because as soon as I put a sentence down, I want to, as they say, I want to qualify it with 50 footnotes, you know. And so at one level, they're clearly saying something which I think is, dare I even say, important. So I'm, you know, I'm not really knocking them at that sort of level. I mean, I guess it's partly a turf war. They're so rude about philosophy. But it's not just that. It's a feeling that if you're going to talk about these things, they're serious things. And my whole being as a teacher is to say serious topics require serious discussion. And the most important thing, I think, I've always said this, particularly as a philosopher, is to try to understand the other person's position. When I'm teaching philosophy of religion, I get the kids to put up their hands, and about a third of them will say that they're evangelical Christians. And I say, okay, I want you to write the essays on why there is no God. And those of you who think of yourselves as new atheists, to write essays on why there is a God. Because I say, it's not, you know, I'm not trying to destroy your faith or anything like that. But I always argue that if you're going to understand a position and argue for your own position, you've got to understand what it is that other people have are what it is that make it attractive to others. I mean, we were talking at supper. I mean, what else does one talk about? The Trump phenomenon scares the hell out of me. But I think, dear God, I mean, yeah, I'm prepared to be a Christian until Tuesday afternoon, anyhow. But you hear that? But I think at a more mature level, I think what we've got to do, say, with somebody like Trump, is not just to go against his arguments, but to try to understand what it is that he's saying that people are finding so attractive. There was a very interesting article in the New York Times today about the veterans who are saying, well, you know, yeah, the man's a total asshole. But, you know, and he said terrible things about veterans, and yet we're neglected. People are not caring about us, and we think that he might be. So I feel that if you're trying to understand people, that what you must try to understand is what makes the other side attractive. And that's what upsets me about, particularly about Dawkins, perhaps less about Dan Dennett, because he is, after all, a philosopher, but particularly about Dawkins, is that he seems to make no effort whatsoever to try to understand, for instance, why people would find Christianity or Judaism. Why would they find it compelling? What is it, and we were talking again over supper, what is it about the Old Testament that people can return to again and again and again and say, yeah, the God of the Old Testament in many respects is, as I like to say, is a little bit like my headmaster. You know, not somebody I want to meet either on this side of the grave or on the other side. And yet, there's something about the Old Testament, about the New Testament, which is clearly valuable. And if you, I mean, yeah, if at the end you want to say, but I think that, let's say, the sexual abuse of the priests outweighs the value of discussions about, let's say, just war theory that the theologians did. On balance, I think we'd have been better off without either. I can understand that, but I think that's an informed decision that cries out in me as a philosopher and as a teacher, one should do, and it's so very clearly that Dawkins is emoting. You know, frankly, if Richard Dawkins converted in the next, you know, couple of years, I, for one, would not be surprised. People who are that committed, I mean, they're like St. Paul. St. Paul wasn't a regular guy when he converted to Christianity. He was a fanatic about Christianity. He was the guy who held the coats while they stoned St. Stephen. I mean, this guy was a real fanatic. And then suddenly he switches and he's a fanatic the other way. If that happened to Dawkins, it happened to Tony Flew, it would, I mean, I don't think it's going to happen. But it wouldn't entirely surprise me.
Okay, so let's shift to a sort of maybe friendlier ground in religion and science. I want to ask you to talk a little bit about, probably in the last 25 years, one of the ideas that received most traction in the popular culture. Oh, it strikes me as honestly somewhat preposterous and yet got a lot of traction, which is Stephen Jay Gould's notion of non-overlapping magisteria, or what's called noma. So Gould essentially argued, right, that the net of science covers the empirical world, whereas the net of religion covers questions of value, moral meaning, etc. And he insisted, right, that these two magisteria, magisteria meaning forms of teaching, these two magisteria never touched each other, right? To give you one of his most famous sentences, this is him talking, to cite the arch cliches, we, the scientists, get the age of rocks, and religion retains the rock of ages. We study how the heavens go, and they determine how to go to heaven. Now, like many others, you have pointed out that there is a fundamental and unresolved ambiguity about what belongs to science and what religion. Because lo and behold, while Stephen Jay Gould says he's carving out space for religion, in fact, almost all of what religious people care about and think about as religion is now off the table. We can't make any ontological claims about the world. If you're a Christian, resurrection, incarnation, resurrection, it's all gone. God is creator, it's gone. What does religion give you, essentially? Well, we can talk about, like, what's important to us and the meaning of our lives. So What, if anything, is useful in what Gould is saying? Oh, you've been very critical of it. But what's useful in that notion of non-overlapping magisteria?
Good question. Let me show my enthusiasm as an evolutionist here and say that you can't really understand the present unless you understand the past. Gould's notion of non-overlapping magisteria didn't come out of nowhere, and it did not, believe it or not, come out of the fertile mind of Stephen Jay Gould. It goes back at least to the beginning of this century and to the work of the person that many think certainly the greatest Protestant theologian of the 20th century, if not overall, Karl Barth, the Swiss theologian. And Barth developed this system, which later, it wasn't his term, is known as neo-orthodoxy. Barth was very keen to keep natural theology arguments and these sort of that kind, empirical arguments, out of religion. He wanted to say that if you're going to believe that Jesus Christ is your savior, and of course this goes back to people like Kierkegaard, then you've got to take it on faith. And faith isn't faith if you can prove it on the side. In other words, as Kierkegaard said, faith has to be this leap into the absurd. And that, I think, is very much part of Barth's position. Now, that doesn't mean to say that Barth, or certainly the Neo-Barthians, or Neo-Orthodox, as they called themselves, that doesn't mean to say they wanted to put the boot into science, but they wanted to say that religious claims and scientific claims are not the same sort of thing. And probably one of the most best-known Neo-Barthians in the second half of the 20th century was a theologian, a Baptist theologian at Chicago Divinity School called Langdon Gilkey. And his example he'd like to give is, ask the question, what did you do yesterday? And one answer would be, well, the family and I, we made some sandwiches and we got in the car and we drove to the park or to the river and we ate the sandwiches and played some games and then we drove home and got caught in a traffic jam on the way home. And he said, that's a perfectly good answer. Now, what did you do yesterday? Well, it was my wife's birthday and the kids and I wanted to show our love for her, so we made some sandwiches. Dear God, they were pretty awful. If she'd made them, they would have been a lot better, but we made them. And we took her to the park, and because we know that she likes to do these, what she really likes to do is family things, and where the kids are playing and happy. And we celebrated her birthday there, and we all came home dog-tired. Two completely different answers, but not in any sense contradicting each other. In some sense, different sorts of answers. And this was Gilkey's position about science and religion. Now, Gilkey and Steve Gould and I were all witnesses for the ACLU in 1981 in Arkansas, when the state of Arkansas, and this was an interregnum, Clinton had been governor and got kicked out in 1980 and came back in 82. And the governor in between, who was as surprised as he was inadequate to the job, signed a bill which said that if evolution is taught in schools, then creationism, Bible taken literally, can be taught too. And so the ACLU brought suit against it. It was overthrown. But the line the ACLU made us all take was, and that's why they got Gilkey, was not that religion is bad or that creation is bad, because apart from anything else, the Constitution doesn't go against the teaching of bad religion. The Constitution goes against the teaching of or bad science. The Constitution goes against the teaching of religion in state schools. And so that had to be the strategy that we took. So we all absorbed this neo-orthodox thing. And then 20 years later, Steve, to his great credit, took this up and talked about this in his book, and this was his position. Basically, that we've got science and religion, and they're what he called magisteria, and they don't overlap. Now, except, of course, what Gould did was go one step further, as you point out, and he didn't just want to say science and religion are different, but he wanted to say that science makes all the, what we philosophers would call the ontological claims, all the claims about existence. And religion is just about ethics and emotion and those sorts of things. And of course, religious people immediately kicked up and said, oh no, That's just not so. We may not be right, but we want to make claims about existence, that God exists, that God is creator, that humans have some special place in God's plan, and of course, if you're Christians, that Jesus is the Son of God, and probably some ontological claims about it's not just myth-making, about the idea of life after death, and these sorts of things. And so, of course, Christians, I think, went after, well, not just Christians, but religious people generally, and I think rightly, went after Gould and said, you've won, it's a Pyrrhic victory, you've won, but only by making religion so thin that none of us would really give a damn about it. And so basically, I think that's where the discussion was left. Now, I think, and I'm not the only one, who wanted to say, but nevertheless, there's something to this. The point is, religious claims are not scientific claims. And as soon as you start making religious claims scientific claims, then you're in trouble. As soon as people started to say the Big Bang proves Genesis, then you're in trouble because, you know, what happens if somebody said, well, the Big Bang didn't, there were Big Bangs before the Big Bang. Does that mean that Genesis was, you know, that there should be, you know, Genesis minus one and minus two and minus three dealing with other creation stories? So the argument was, stay away from these and recognize that that religious claims, like God exists, are not scientific claims. That the whole very nature of God as a necessary being, I mean, which is, of course, again, very much the sort of Augustinian, Aquinas, Thomistic position, that God is not a person, but that God is a something very much like the Platonic form of the good, a being which is outside time and space and all of these sort of things. This is not a scientific claim at all. But it doesn't mean to say that it's not an ontological claim. It doesn't mean to say that it's not a claim about existence. It's just a claim of a different kind. So my answer to, you know, on Gould is, you know, B plus, well, perhaps B, you know, not bad, but could do better.
I'm sure he'd have been flattered.
yeah, I'm sure he wouldn't be.
Let's actually dig deeper a little bit into kind of the philosophical issues at stake here. I want to ask you, before we start talking about Darwin in particular, to talk about the distinction between what is called methodological naturalism on the one hand and metaphysical naturalism on the other, right? Methodological naturalism, right, is essentially the claim that in doing science, one assumes that there are no God-directed interventions in the world. Metaphysical naturalism, in contrast, assumes that there are no God-directed interventions in the world, period. Science is committed to the former, you insist, but not to the latter. I want to ask you how you would respond to those who insist that methodological naturalism leads sort of ineluctably, inexorably, to metaphysical naturalism. Because one of the things I think is really striking in the culture is that that argument is shared both by the most outspoken atheists, Dawkins clearly thinks that, and also by the crowd that defends intelligent design. They make exactly the same argument, only one says, yes, that's why, you know, metaphysical naturalism is true, and the other says that's why methodological naturalism is itself bankrupt. Right? But that the fact is, if you think about doing science that way, you will end up inexorably thinking about the world that way. And maybe if I could, I just want to sharpen it one step further, which is to say, how do you respond to someone who says, look, methodological naturalism has been so successful at explaining so much about our experience of the world that of course it should lead us to adopt metaphysical naturalism? I know I'm asking this to someone who's not a theist, but I know, how would you respond to that kind of dogmatic claim?
Well, obviously, if you think of methodological naturalism is what the scientist does from Monday through Friday, and metaphysical naturalism is what the theist does not do on Saturday and Sunday, then they're two different things. But obviously, at some level, they're going to be connected. You could hardly be a metaphysical naturalist without being a methodological naturalist. If you don't think that there is a God, you don't think that there are any miracles, you don't think that there's any ultimate meaning or something like that, then clearly you're not going to appeal to God's intervention when you've got a gene that you can't quite explain, or something like that. I mean, you're just, or if a disease comes along, or somebody's cured, or something like that, why did it do it? Well, God did it, or something like that. You obviously can't and you won't go that way. The question is, interesting, and the question that you've posed is, what about going the other way? If you think you can do things without an appeal to God, does this make you more inclined not to believe in God? In other words, if you find that methodologically you can be a naturalist very happily, does this incline you to say on Saturday morning, oh, to hell with it, I'll sleep in, or on Sundays to say, well, yeah, I'll get up, and if you're in England, I'll go to the pub, but I think I'll give Mass or Holy Communion a bit of a miss? And I don't think anybody would want to say that that's never happened. Maybe it happens quite a bit. But it's very interesting, because even before this debate came up, historians were looking at this very problem. And particularly in the context, there's one very good book written in the context of non-belief in the 19th century amongst English intellectuals. People like Charles Darwin, Thomas Henry Huxley, and the great novelists like Thomas Hardy, and particularly George Eliot, all of whom, by the end of their lives, had slid into, usually they weren't atheists, but had slid into what Thomas Henry Huxley called agnosticism. Namely, they didn't think the Christian God existed. They didn't themselves have any feeling about any God, but they didn't want to say there was no God. In other words, they said, well, one just simply has to be open-minded about that, but at least as far as we're living, let's just get on with it. And people had looked at this, and particularly they'd asked the question, particularly did the coming of Darwinian evolutionary theory make people into agnostics or into atheists? And the answer was, surprisingly, no, it didn't. Somebody went through the autobiographies of about 50 Victorians. The Victorians were very much given to writing autobiographies, some of which got published and others didn't. But they were very much given to that sort of, writing about those very sorts of things. And they went through and they found, and Darwin was a case in point. Darwin grew up as an Anglican. There were Unitarian threads in the family too, but he grew up as an Anglican, and we now realize, in fact, he was probably quite an evangelical Anglican, because the family were very much opposed to slavery, and the people who were in the Anglican church who were most strongly against slavery at the beginning of the 19th century in the Anglican church were the evangelicals. So even if the Darwins weren't evangelical themselves, certainly Darwin's sisters were, and it's probably that true that Darwin was, even when he went to Cambridge. But then he went on the Beagle voyage, and increasingly he realized, or he felt, that the miracles were no longer, he couldn't accept miracles. And with that, his Christian faith started to fade. But right through the writing of The Origin of Species, he was at the very least a deist. He certainly believed in a God. And if you read The Origin of Species, there's lots of references to the Creator. And don't say, oh, he just threw them in to keep the troops happy. If you look at them, it's quite clear that Darwin believes that being an evolutionist is truer to his God, a God who's so powerful he can work through unbroken law, than to a God who, as it were, has to work by hand and do these things. And the industrial metaphor keeps coming up. A God who can work through machines, like the British, are superior to a God who has to do it all by hand, like the rest of the world. So if they don't, there were all these threads. And then in the 1860s, Darwin lost his faith and became never an atheist, but at least an agnostic. And Darwin said, the reason why I can no longer believe in God is because I cannot accept the idea that non-believers will go to hell because they're non-believers. My father and my brother are two of the best people I've ever known. They're both non-believers, and I cannot believe that these people are going to go to hell because of their non-belief. My father particularly, who gave so much to so many people, he was a physician. You know, he said it just doesn't make sense. And again and again and again, it was that which turned people away from the Christian, or in the British case, usually, almost always, the Christian God. Usually, and certainly, the Protestant God. It was again and again and again, it was the theological issues of people like George Eliot. George Eliot translated Strauss, David Strauss, for instance, again and again. Thomas Henry Huxley. It wasn't evolution that turned him against this. It was other things and theological issues. And so my answer to that, to both sides is, of course, I can't say there was nobody ever who was turned, became a methodological naturalist on a Monday and said on a Tuesday, I'm going to be a metaphysical naturalist. I'm sure there were. But by and large, it's not what, and I can speak to myself. It, for me, it's the problem of evil. For me, it's the death of Anne Frank in Bergen-Belsen and Sophie Scholl of the White Rose Group, who was guillotined for passing out anti-Nazi messages in Munich in, what was it, 1942, 1943. That, for me, means I don't want to believe in God. I just don't want to believe in God. If my salvation depends on Anne Frank dying in Bergen-Belsen and Sophie Scholl dying on the guillotine, you know, you could take your God and stuff him.
Okay, so...
Sorry, I'm expecting it, the heavens to open at this moment. Or the hell. I saw Don Giovanni last week, you know. Repent. No, repent. Okay, it's too late. You're going down there, mate.
So, this was not a question I was planning to ask.
It's not how you intended this to go, is it?
Hey, you know what?
You thought this was going to be dignified, that you're a rabbi and you're going to just beat the hell out of me and I'm going to be just very careful. Yes, rabbi, yeah. No rabbi, you're certainly rabbi.
Yeah, you are up here crimping my style, that is for sure. But I want to actually ask you, this was not what I was planning to ask you, but in light of what you just said about, you know, the impassioned articulation of the problem of evil, one of the interesting debates in philosophy of religion these days is about the question of whether the immense suffering caused by natural selection raises some kind of new philosophical problem. We even have this new discussion in philosophy of religion called evolutionary theodicy, mm-hmm. right? There is unimaginable suffering in the animal kingdom as life unfolds. 98%+ of species that have ever existed have gone extinct. You just articulated the problem of evil in a very sort of down-to-earth human way. The unimaginable suffering of innocent people and a God who appears to remain utterly silent. But do you think that what science has taught us in any way amplifies or exacerbates that problem?
I think if it does exacerbate the problem, I think it's important to note that it's not a new problem. And to be fair, let me say to Christians, they do have answers which aren't stupid. I mean, the point is, we've known about the problem of evil well before Charles Darwin appeared on the scene. I mean, you've only got to read the Old Testament to know about that, to know about suffering, and to know that not all suffering is caused by humans, that suffering is also caused by natural phenomena. In fact, you know, philosophers draw a distinction between moral evil and natural evil. The evil of Auschwitz, moral evil, and the evil of the Lisbon earthquake, natural evil. So we know about that. And so at one level, the coming of evolutionary theory is nothing new. You're right, it intensifies it, but it's not a new, logically new thing. And of course, there is a standard answer to this, which is usually ascribed to Leibniz, although I'm sure he wasn't the first, namely that God can't do the impossible, that God can't make 2 plus 2 equal 5. I mean, although, in fact, probably Descartes thought that God could, but by and large, it's felt that God could not, in fact, do the impossible. And that when God created, it was bound to be a mixed bag. That pain, for instance, if you sit on a stove and it's turned on, you're going to feel pain. But it's better that you feel pain than 10 minutes later you start to say, "My God, that chicken smells good." And you know, the point is, we know that people who, yeah, right. We know that people who, in fact, can't feel pain usually don't live that long because things happen to them and they die because they're not cautious about it. So the usual argument is that in order to get these ends, it was bound to be a mixed bag. And interestingly, and I think almost paradoxically, of all people, Richard Dawkins helps this argument, because Dawkins is on record as saying, I think, this I'm now saying in what Dawkins says, I think the only way that you could get the complex design of organisms, adaptations, is through natural selection, if you're going to do it naturally. In other words, Dawkins says, if God were going to create and was going to create humans and other organisms, the only way that he could do it would be through natural selection. Now, I'm not quite sure about that, but I don't think it's a silly argument. In other words, the evil is part and parcel of what happens. So at least that explains some evil. Now, of course, the counter-argument, and I'm not indifferent to this, is, well, if then God shouldn't have done it in the first place. If God knew that in order to achieve the ends, namely the eternal salvation or not of Michael Ruse, and he knew that it was going to involve small children dying of cancer along the way and all of the other horrible things. I'm not even talking about moral evil. I'm talking about natural evil. All the horrible things that happen in that respect. Then I'm not sure that, yeah, God should have gotten into the business in the first place. I just don't think the end justified the means. Now, as I say, that's quite apart from the moral evil issue, which I don't take to be at least directly concerned with natural selection, which in many respects I take at least as seriously, if not more seriously, and you'll notice that when I pointed my examples of evil, were precisely moral evil, Anne Frank and Sophie Scholl.
I'm looking at some of the questions that have been passed up, and I want to ask something where I suspect you and I are on the same side of this, but I'm going to ask it anyway, because it's come from a few different people in different versions, which is that you and I are up here talking about a fairly traditional conception of God. And one of the things that has become popular, trendy, in the Jewish world in the last 15 years is, I would say, how should we call this? Less traditional notions of God. I'm just going to speak personally in asking the question because it might reflect some of your own thoughts about this. Questions about religious naturalism, questions about pantheism. For me, as an interpreter of the Jewish tradition, as a theologian, I have a very different response to that pastorally versus philosophically. Pastorally, I have great sympathy for people who feel they can no longer believe in God and want something else that they can call God. That came out rather strong, more strongly than I meant it. But, right? And yet, philosophically, I don't find any of that particularly interesting or Jewishly tenable, right? It seems to me that in order to be able to speak something as a Jewish theology, when I say the word you, it has to mean something coherent, which I think it doesn't in many more, let's call it liberal Protestant or kind of New Age Jewish theologies. But several people asked whether those theologies would be more adequately equipped to deal with the challenges posed by Darwinian by Darwinian theory, the neo-Darwinian synthesis, or what do we want to talk about? You also tend to resist that kind of, you know, the God that you argue with is a robustly conservative Protestant God, right? You're not interested in Paul Tillich, you're interested in Karl Barth.
Well, yes and no. I hate to say this, but another book I wrote was about the Gaia hypothesis. And this led me into, actually, I went out and interviewed a couple of pagans and very much got me into some of these alternative. I mean, let's backtrack. There are more alternatives than just one alternative. And they're not necessarily that new. Because for instance, Plato, I think, one can argue for a pantheistic view, particularly in the Timaeus, for instance. So the idea of some sort of pantheism, that God or nature, which is what Spinoza talked about, who was in fact Jewish, although they expelled him. But certainly, that's got a long tradition, and I think you find it in people like Emerson and Thoreau, for instance, that sort of thing. And then, of course, there are others, say, who follow Whitehead, who want to argue for a God who, at some level, what the technical term is known as kenosis, who has voluntarily given up some of his powers, particularly, for instance, to die on the cross. And so the Whiteheadian God, the God of process theology, is far from being everywhere. This is a God who's in the trenches with us, who's working alongside us. So, I mean, these are certainly non-traditional things. But let's pick up, as you said, about you mentioned the pantheistic view. On the one hand, there's no question, this is certainly from a Christian point of view, heretical. That if you ask the evangelical Christians, I mean, I've got a chap at the head of biology at Wheaton College, which is where Billy Graham was, the evangelical college, in Illinois, I think, who says just flatly, the Gaia hypothesis, the idea of a God who is somehow diffused through the whole thing, at some level identical with existence, is heretical. That the earth and everything in it is the creation of a God who's separate and that gets its values only from that separate thing. Whereas, of course, people who are pantheists tend to see value in the world in itself. And so, for instance, why shouldn't I chop down this tree? The Christian response would be because it's God wouldn't like it or because it'd be bad for us. The pantheistic argument would be you shouldn't chop it down because the tree has rights in its own right, as it were. It has value in itself, and so we've all got to get along. Now, you said, you know, you don't find this interesting. Funnily enough, I don't believe it, but I don't find myself as opposed to it as I thought I would be. Partly because I really like the pagans. I went out and interviewed these people, and they, you know, they're a bit like Unitarians. In fact, interestingly, quite a few Unitarians would in fact identify as pagans as well. You know, it's the American way, be ecumenical about these things. So, at one level, they're really nice people. So I find myself sympathetic. The thing I like about these people is they were environmentalists before we were environmentalists. These were people who really are dedicated to the world as something of value. And they didn't have to be told about global warming to think that. They didn't have to say, oh my God, if we don't do something about this, Miami's going to be underwater by the end of... Well, those of you who live in North Florida don't think that's a bad idea, but you know what I mean. Oh my God, if we're not careful, we're all going to have to go to North Dakota and live in yurts and live off vegetables. Crikey, can you imagine anything worse than that? I mean, no. I mean, but these people were environmentalists before we were. So I don't think it's true, but at a certain level, I just have to say that I think there's something to that whole pagan, Spinozistic, transcendentalist world picture that I find, I'm empathetic to it in a way that I'm not empathetic to evangelical Christianity.
Wow, there's a lot we could talk about there. A lot. But I want to, since we have limited time, I want to ask you about a couple of kind of contested philosophical topics that are right here at the nexus of science and religion and the question of methodological and metaphysical naturalism. I want to ask you specifically about consciousness. And I want to do it actually, I want to start at least by asking you in your own words. You write the following. What is consciousness and what function does it serve? Why should not an unconscious machine do everything that we can do? Is consciousness just froth sitting on top of the brain's electronics? Is it a powerless epiphenomenon, to use the language of philosophy? And then you respond, almost certainly not. One major function is that of serving as a filter and a guide and a coordinator to all of the information thrown up by the brain. Consciousness sees that the brain does not get clogged up with overload of material that it does not need and cannot use. That is an answer, or it is an attempt at an answer of what consciousness is. However, when we move to the question of why consciousness is, you say something that I think is actually startling for a philosopher and a scientist, or philosopher of science. I'm going to quote you here again. No one, certainly not the Darwinian as such, seems to have any answer to this. The point is that there is no scientific answer. There is no scientific answer to why there is consciousness. So first, I want to ask you, do you mean that there is no scientific answer yet available, or that there is in principle no scientific answer? And then I want to take it one step further. I have a friend who is a renowned theoretical physicist who has the following life story. He talks about having been, like many of his colleagues in physics, an atheist for his entire adult life, until he spent a couple of years reading biologists on the nature of consciousness and neuroscientists, at which point he was led to the conclusion that the only plausible way to think about where consciousness comes from is if there's a consciousness underlying the universe. And it's an amazingly rare story in this day and age. He talks about literally going out of his office and driving to the Barnes & Noble and saying, where do you keep the Bibles? And he is now a fairly observant religious Jew. And basically, essentially says, look, I just feel that most philosophers of science who talk about consciousness are blowing smoke. We could talk about a non-theistic figure. We could talk about Thomas Nagel, who, right in 2012, wrote a book essentially arguing, this is all ridiculous. We've said absolutely nothing useful about consciousness. And to quote the inimitable phrase of Leon Wieseltier, Tom Nagel was then lynched by a Darwinist mob, right? Just essentially savage for having had the gall to say, look, I just don't find any of this stuff interesting as an explanation of consciousness. So what do you make? I mean, how would you respond to this friend of mine's narrative of his own life? I mean, right, a serious scientist who says, you know what, I just don't find we have anything to say as scientists about consciousness at this point. And how should we understand you're saying there is no scientific answer? Is that an invitation to a theological answer?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, let's just start with Darwinism and then take the broader question. You see, my attitude about Darwinism is I'm not sure that it's the job of Darwinism to solve the problem of consciousness any more than it's the job of organic chemistry to solve the problem of consciousness. Well, but we don't criticize organic chemistry and say, oh, well, you haven't solved the problem of consciousness. Why should I take organic chemistry? And it's the same. No, okay, you could say, but the analogy is not quite fair. Of course, obviously, in biology, and particularly evolutionary biology, you're going to use notions of consciousness. You're going to say, well, it seems to us at some level, clearly the bonobos, let's say, are conscious. And clearly their consciousness is used by them in order to lead the kind of lives that they do. I mean, we know, for instance, that bonobos, unlike other chimpanzees, the way that they get on is by having lots and lots of sex. I mean, they have huge amounts, you know, more than adolescent schoolboys could ever dream of. And it's pretty clear that this is all very much an adaptive strategy that people like people who've looked at these sorts of things have shown that it helps to keep hierarchies, it helps to build alliances, and all of these sorts of things. In other words, it has a point. It doesn't just happen. But it's pretty clear that some perhaps rudimentary or whatever it is level of consciousness is involved, and I don't think any primatologist working on these sorts of things would want to deny consciousness. I'm not sure, though, that they have to explain what is consciousness in some ultimate sense any more than they have to explain what is oxygen. I mean, oxygen is obviously, we know, is a very important evolutionary notion. And, you know, 2 billion years ago, when organisms discovered how they could start using oxygen rather than having it poison them, was a very fundamental evolutionary breakthrough. But I don't think anybody goes back and says to people, paleontologists who work on these sorts of issues, oh, well, you know, if you can't explain to us what the ultimate chemistry, the ultimate meaning of oxygen is, you're not doing your job. Well, you know, I think that we'd want to say, no, you missed the point. At a certain level, it's like, you know, the cookbook, first take your hair, and then, and I would be inclined to say the same with consciousness. So I think that Nagel, when he goes after evolutionary biology, is being unfair there. Having said that, he may lose the battle, but I think he wins the war, in the sense that I think he's putting his finger on a problem. And I, you know, like your chemist friend, physicist friend, increasingly I'm inclined to say that science as we have it at the moment can't solve consciousness. In fact, in a way, it sets out not to solve consciousness, because as Leibniz pointed out, I mean, we all work within the, we're mechanists, and the machine model, as Leibniz pointed out, machines don't think. You can open up a machine and you don't see consciousness. So in a way, I would say that modern, including modern evolutionary biology, almost precludes giving an answer to consciousness, because it's rather like, you know, as I say about Steve Weinberg, when he says, the more I look at the world, the less, you know, meaning I see. I say, you know, but the whole point, Steve, is that you've got a way of doing science where meaning is excluded before you started. And my feeling is we've got a way of doing science where consciousness at that sort of level is excluded before we start it. Now, does this mean that it would be impossible to have a new paradigm, if you like, a new root metaphor rather than the world as a machine that that would, in some sense, throw light on consciousness? Well, if I knew that, I'd be, you know, following it and winning Nobel Prizes. I don't know. But maybe J.B.S. Haldane said that, even Richard Dawkins said this. There's no reason why mid-range primates with adaptations for getting out of the jungle and getting onto the plains, we do pretty well, but there's no ultimate reason why we should be able to solve all of life's mysteries, particularly those of us who are not Christians. There's no reason why evolution should have made us able to understand everything. I mean, you know, like quantum mechanics, there's no reason why, ultimately, we're going to be able to say, and now we know why, you know, particles look like waves sometimes. Or maybe those are not only unanswered, but unanswerable questions. And I'm inclined to say the same about consciousness. The third thing, and in a way I'm going with Nagel and I'm going with your physicist friend, but what does this add up to at the end? Well, maybe some kind of panpsychic monism, that we should recognize that consciousness isn't just a thing which occurs suddenly. Bingo, we've got a machine. Bingo, we've got a ghost in the machine. Maybe at some level, it goes back. Now, that doesn't mean like that, you know, we can follow Prince Charles and talk to plants and expect them to answer back. No, it doesn't. But it does mean that consciousness isn't just a question of organization, but that maybe it's something inherent in the very nature of existence. Now, why that should then lead us to God, I'm not quite sure. Even, or to pantheism. Yeah, at some level you're saying it's all there. But it doesn't mean to say that it's I mean, a god in the sense of a thinking being or anything like that, or that I should get the Bible out and do. No, I just, that seems to me to be a non sequitur there.
It seems to me that one of the things that you are implicitly saying here, which should be an obvious point and yet is not with certain scientists today, is that the idea that only questions that can be answered by science are meaningful questions. One of the things I'm astounded by as a philosopher is how many scientists seem to believe that today, which I find actually almost inexplicable, right? The sort of the reduction of what's a legitimate question. We thought positivism was dead, but it's not. It's revived in this kind of, you know, that Nobel Prize winning scientists can say things like, philosophy has been eliminated because science now does its job. I mean, which is honestly comical, and yet widespread.
Well, I think it's an ideology that's fed to scientists. I mean, why is Karl Popper is almost the patron saint of science. Why? Because he makes them look good. Because, you know, here is your, you know, little scientist who's battling on against the theories that people have held all these years, but because, you know, he's been able to falsify Newtonian physics, we go on, and by God, he looks good. And don't forget, there's a lot of money involved in this. I mean, scientists exist on soft money, so they've got to, at some level, set themselves up as priests, if you like, that the society. Now, that's cynical, because obviously we can do a lot with science, although I don't think we can always do as much with science as scientists claim. You know, the big joke, the guy who solves the problem of cancer is going to be the most hated person in the whole biomedical community, because it's going to mean the end of grants. But, I mean, you know, and that's cynical, but it's not entirely. And so I, you know, there's a lot of ideology which is fed to PhD students. Thank God they believe it, they mouth it, but when they go home, they don't act it. And they, you know, they go on, you know, by and large, scientists, you know, are fairly normal people out, you know, when you get to know them. You know, it sometimes it can be difficult because they tend to be terribly arrogant. Oh, well, you're just a philosopher. Well, fuck you too, really. You know, because that's part of my problem with Dawkins is the arrogance of somebody who thinks they'll, you know, I heard Dawkins once say, oh, well, philosophy, why don't we just get some bright people together and have a few drinks? And I thought, up yours too, mate. I mean, you know, I mean, he's dissing Plato, Aristotle, Aquinas, I mean, you know, Maimonides. I mean, no, you know, this is not on. It's a turf war, partly.
Since time is running out, I want to ask two more questions. One, I'm trying to synthesize questions that come in, which will leave everyone here feeling like I didn't actually ask their question. But I want to try to synthesize. It's fascinating, and it encapsulates a lot, that two of the questions that were asked, one person said, do findings in cognitive science and psychology about how people come to believe make it more plausible to believe in God? And one person asked, do findings in cognitive science and psychology make it obvious that it makes no sense to believe in God? So I want to ask you what you think about that question. I mean, I'll tell you, it's interesting that you have certain people who seem to think, certain scientists usually, who think that explaining a phenomenon is equivalent to explaining it away, which strikes me as a highly odd thing to assume.
I don't think it's that odd. I think it's a bit of a balance. You take Tony Flew, who was one of the world's best-known atheists until the end of his life when he, you know, became a theist. Now, Tony Flew had a very famous father who was a Methodist, who was a theologian at Oxford, and a very famous, well-known, he was not ordained, he was a lay preacher. And I remember asking Flew once, I said, well, Tony, is this all a little bit Oedipal, that you're an atheist because you're getting at your dad? And he thought about it, he laughed, he said, you know, there's probably something to that. And now does that mean that Flew's atheism was nothing more than a guy who'd got a heavy-duty Oedipus complex? And that, no, I don't think that's true. I think that we can certainly look at the arguments that Flew and others were putting forward about the problem of evil and these sorts of things. So it doesn't deny the relevance of these. But I do think it sometimes makes us a little bit wondering, particularly when you get enthusiasm, about to what is driving people here? What is making people really think? Give you a personal example this afternoon. I'm writing a book on war, and what I'm doing is comparing Darwinism and Christianity on theories of war. And so I was reading, actually, it was a commentary on Karl Barth on war. And by and large, the person who was writing it said, by and large, Barth was a pacifist. He was so shocked by the First World War and the way that the theologians all jumped on board, you know, promoting the war, that it repelled him. And that by and large, he was a pacifist. But then he made one exception. Small countries which are threatened from outside have a moral obligation to defend themselves. And what was his example? Switzerland. And I thought to myself, you know, I'm not sure about this. You know, Switzerland. The guy's Swiss, he lived, and yeah. Maybe it was just that I had gone to William Tell last night, and which is an opera all about, you know, the Swiss defending themselves against the Austrians. But it just left me with that hesitancy about the quality of Barth's arguments. And I wanted to go back, as in fact the commentator I was reading did, I want to go back and at least look that much more carefully at the arguments that Barth puts forward for making these exceptions. So, as I say, I think it's a balanced thing. I don't think you can just simply say, oh, well, he's a Jew, he's a Brit, he's whatever it is, she's a woman, and that explains it. No, but I don't think it's always totally irrelevant to ask, well, what is driving people, as I say, particularly when there's enthusiasm involved.
Well, so maybe I just push you one step further before I ask you the last question, which is, it seems to me that part of what goes on here is that the assumption, let's take the atheistic interpretation for a minute, that the assumption of atheism comes from elsewhere, and then the sort of scientific explanation of how a belief emerges is then marshaled to bolster the atheistic case, which is prior, right? Because one might, let's take an example, recent cognitive scientific writing on sort of how and why people come to believe in God. So, if you're starting out from an atheistic perspective or from a kind of, you know, broadly naturalistic perspective, you say, okay, I've now explained why people believe it even though it's implausible. On the other hand, if you start out as a theist, you might say, well, wait a minute. If I believe in a God who wants human beings to be in relationship with God, then presumably there's going to be something in human nature that points them in that direction. And so what really is at stake is the illusion that it's actually the science that leads to the atheistic assumption or the naturalistic assumption, whereas in fact, the metaphysical commitments are prior, and then I pull on the science to bolster those prior metaphysical commitments. I think it's very rare that's not the case, and we can take absurd examples, right? I desperately want to believe when I go home tonight that my wife loves me. This has not exposed that as untrue, right? Freud believes, I desperately want to believe in God. This similarly does not expose it as untrue. It perhaps ought to make me interrogate whether I have good reasons other than my desperate want to believe it. But the notion that, again, that explanation is the same as explaining away just strikes me as philosophically totally implausible.
Well,
uncharitable.
Yeah. Well, first of all, my attitude is if somebody wants to believe in the existence of God, I'm not going to knock it. They can do it, unless and until they start infringing on my freedoms and the freedoms of others. I mean, I don't care if somebody takes the Bible literally. I do care if somebody says women can't have abortions. The Zika virus, for instance, as Marco Rubio is saying. Oh, no, if a woman is pregnant and has got the Zika virus, no abortions, absolutely not. Now, that's when I want to start arguing against the religion. So at one level, I don't want to. But on the other hand, if somebody comes to me and says, Mike, I don't think you're reasonable. I have the faith and you don't. Then I think we can argue. And you said science, but of course I'm a philosopher. I want to argue these things at the metaphysical level too.
Great.
I want to argue things like, for instance, the Christian religion. Does the Christian God make sense? On the one hand, we've got the Greek component of God as a necessary being outside time and space. On the other hand, the Christian's got the Jewish component of God as a person who walked in the cool of the evening. Can one bring these two together in a satisfactory sort of way? Can a being which is outside time and space truly be loving? I mean, we're told that God never suffers. God never, I mean, this is standard Catholic theology. Both St. Anselm and St. Thomas said that God feels no suffering. Well, you know, I don't want a God who wasn't, you know, not just cheesed off, but deeply hurt at the death of those two women, Anne Frank and Sophie Scholl. So, you know, I think I can argue with somebody at that level. But ultimately, of course, I don't have faith and they do. And I'm not going to say, you know, that rules you out of any discourse with me. But why do you think they've got it and you don't? Then ultimately, obviously, I'm going to say, well, at some level, it is a matter of psychology. It is a matter of psychology. But I would hope that it doesn't mean to say that neither, well, certainly in my case, that I could never have my mind changed. I mean, as I say, I talked about panpsychic monism. This is, you know, really something which really rather surprises me, that I'm starting to think that there might be something to this nutty idea. I mean, but, you know, I'd like to say, but that's part of being a rational person.
So I want to ask you before we run out of time, what is perhaps an odd question to ask an atheist, but it's, you know, tradition in philosophy to ask someone to give advice to people who hold the opposite position. So I've been spending a lot of time in recent months reading Christians who you could broadly describe as evolutionary theists or advocates of theistic evolution. And they essentially find themselves in a bind, right? On the one hand, as theists, they want to attribute natural selection to God. But then they have to deal, as we've already talked about, with the enormous, almost unimaginable degree of suffering that the evolutionary process unfolds in the world. To which they respond, to which we respond, by essentially making some kind of argument about how God surrenders some of God's power, what you referred to kenosis earlier. But then the danger is we begin to sound like deists. Mm-hmm.
No,
and
I don't.
So how do you suggest that people negotiate that rock in that hard place?
Well, I mean, there are standard arguments. And as I say, maybe Darwinism makes the problem more pressing. But it's not a new argument from Darwinism. And it's not an argument of a different logical type. I mean, for instance, John Hick, who I think was a very thoughtful Christian philosopher, spoke in terms of, you know, he liked to quote Keats, that this world is a veil of soul-making. That, in fact, it is because it is a difficult, harsh world that at some level we have the opportunity and the chance to better ourselves, not in the sense of making more money, but somehow to grow through these things. Now, whether that's true or not, I think sometimes people just get crushed by their misfortunes. I mean, I was talking about the movie The Pawnbroker. The Pawnbroker, you know, where Rod Steiger plays this chap who was in the Holocaust and then becomes a pawnbroker in the Bronx. And he doesn't see, maybe he does, but he doesn't seem to grow. So maybe, you know, it's not necessarily a veil of, it can be a veil of soul crushing. But at least that's an argument which I think is a serious one. And I think that that's what I would say, that's the kind of argument that I would have with a believer. Now, I don't myself find it ultimately convincing, but I don't find it a stupid argument to make. And I think that these are the resources that a serious believer has. I mean, the point is, and this is where I really do fault Richard Dawkins, he doesn't seem to realize how much we've got at hand to deal with so many of these things. You were faulting me at supper time, for instance. You said, Mike, I think you do really well, except when it comes to the Hebrew Bible. And, you know, well, you were quite right to fault me, certainly to fault Dawkins, by saying, but, you know, that list of negative things that Dawkins says at the beginning of The God Delusion is true, but it's the kind of truth which is so distorting that it's false. Because if you read the Hebrew Bible, yeah, God can be a real meanie at times. And yet at other times, one sees that, you know, it's so much more complex and interesting than that. I mean, how does God deal with Cain, for instance? He doesn't just blast him. He puts a mark on him. But at some level, almost as if God recognizes poor Cain's, you know, yeah, you did a terrible thing. But, you know, yeah, you're human. You were right to fault me on that. So as I say, I think the point is these things are so much more complex. And basically what people need to do is get an education, learn about these things, take these things seriously, and then, you know, qualify yourself for the debate.
Somewhat playfully, in closing, I want to just ask you a question that was the person who asked this will think I did not ask their question, but I'm going to ask their question. Is there an evolutionary explanation for why human beings are able to sit around and have this conversation? And what is it?
In your case, clearly, it was divine intervention. For the rest of us...
I'm glad you're finally able to see it.
Yeah, of course there's an even. I mean, obviously, at one level, we have gone the route, or as you would say, the route of sociality. we are social primates. And obviously, we have developed all sorts of ways of getting on with each other. I mean, in fact, you know, for all the... I mean, Steven Pinker isn't entirely right by any means, but for all the violence that you get going on, we are patsies compared to lemmings, for instance, and to tigers. And I mean, we really are a very social species. Now, did that mean that one evening in November, you and I would end up in a synagogue in, you know, Manhattan? No. But it doesn't mean that what we're doing is a miracle. Or at least it's the best kind of miracle. It's the whole miracle of everything, of existence, and being able to do these things, and the good fortune that we have to do this. And this is what I say to my students, it's what I say to my children. I mean, is enjoy, I don't mean enjoy it by just getting, you know, stinking drunk and pot, or as my daughter likes to do, just going to music festivals at the weekend. But I mean, certainly, that's what I want to say to my students, is enjoy it for what we've got, because that's what being a human being is all about.
I think if there's one thing that's clear from this conversation...
You can't end without the final word, can you, Rabbi?
No, never. Not only that. It's true. It's true. And the final word is repent, Mike, repent. thank you all very much.
Before you race out, I'm going to use a microphone.
Oh, I just turned it off. Take Michael.
Oh, thanks. I first wanted to just acknowledge and thank Rabbi Held and Professor Ruse for this very great conversation. Very thoughtful and very relatable and personable. Thank you for your honesty and your charm. I also wanted to mention again that we partnered to make this happen with the Bronco Foundation. I want to thank them for helping us to make this happen, and remind you that this is actually part of a four-part lecture series that's going to be continuing over the next 4 weeks. We're doing the next two Thursdays in a row. We're skipping a week for Thanksgiving, and then we're going back together on December 1st. I also wanted to point you toward the postcards that are on your seats. They look like this. We are celebrating our 10th year of learning here at Hadar, which is a really, really awesome milestone for us. And so we have two major events that are happening this year in order to celebrate our 10 years of learning. One is a large CM celebration where we are having a 6-month learning project together. And then we are having a Shabbaton, which everybody is invited to, so please join us for that. And lastly, we have available for purchase downstairs Edgar Bronfman's book, Why Be Jewish? So I encourage you to pick it up on your way out and enjoy this really important read.